That's the deal here. Maybe it's this slow.
There we go. Okay, good. So this is, let us say, a pre-tutorial or an introduction. Right? So I have said that there are three kind of different things that we have to attend to, which is how do we program the robots, right? How do we develop the decision-making components, and how do we architect them? Now, most of the tutorials, as I said, are going to be on the decision-making components. So what I'm going to do in this introduction is apply a set bit of the context in terms of architecture and language, right? And then you'll get more of an experience about that in the afternoon labs, right? But otherwise, we won't be talking about that in the morning course. Okay? So the main objective here is to look at those features, okay? And at the beginning of these tutorial slides, you'll see a subset of sample representative tables. Okay? So this is the one that I showed you. So first, I'll talk about architectures, right? And then I'll talk about dynamic languages.
It's going to behave. Okay, so let me kind of begin with architectures, right?
So there's been a lot of work in AI and architectures, right? We kind of love decision-making, right? So we spend a lot of our papers on decision-making. But architecture is very important, right? Used to work with JPL a lot, right? And there it's all about architecture, right? It's how do you think through the system? How do you have an intuitive, simple model in which how the components interact? And if you have a philosophy by architecture, then that shapes how you develop the components, okay? So, if you talk about autonomous systems, right, then what we're trying to do is we're trying to develop architectures to basically allow embedded systems to think. So these are the kinds of systems that we've dealt with in my group over the last many years. We've worked on autonomous space operations, and a number of people here are kind of colleagues I work with, Sun Chung with my first student in my group, right, Bob Morris and the like, right? So, certainly, we want to talk about how do we robustly operate the spacecraft. Over the last 20 years, there's been a lot of focus on information gathering systems, either in the air or under the sea. Right? That's another kind of autonomous system, which is information thinking, seeking. Of course, we have a notion of autonomous cars. There's a huge attention to that, maybe less attention when they're flying cars. Right? Human-robot collaboration, manufacturing. And then there's the notion of a mobile robot, which, or the Internet of Things, right, where we're talking about a physically embedded but immobile system, but you're wanting to coordinate that structure. Okay? And of course, we have our Hollywood versions of these as well, which inspire us, and they either inspire happiness or they inspire fear, right, for the last. Now, if you think about the kinds of abilities you want these systems to be able to have in terms of the overall system, right? Okay, so the first is we want them to be builder operated, right? So rather than programming them in C or Python or whatever language, what we want to be able to do is articulate the goals that we want to achieve and have the system act on those goals, right? There's two reasons we want to do that. First is that we just want to be able to articulate at a higher level what we want the system to do rather than kind of flesh it out the details. The second reason we want to be goal directed is we tell the system what we want to achieve as opposed to a detailed approach to doing it, then it gives the system more flexibility to be able to adapt to failure situations. Right? The system knows what its goals are and has a decision-making capability, then it can think about other courses of action to achieve those goals. And it also can tell if you're doomed to failure, right? That it's impossible to achieve those goals. We'll talk about that later today. Okay, we want robustness. We also want these systems to be efficient, usually, if they're operating in environments where there's not a lot of resources, right? So we do want to optimize the system. But as soon as you start optimizing the system, you tend to move through a point where the system becomes brittle, right? And so although we want the system to optimize, we do want to make sure that it isn't brittle. So in those cases, we want the system to understand what are the risks incurred by trying to optimize the system and make sure that it operates within a level of bounded risk. We'll talk about bounded risk on Friday. And then finally, when we're trying to operate a complex mission, right, or a complex task,
power grid,
right? So
so in these cases, we assume the top-level goals are coming from the human, right? And they may come from the operator, it may come from the user, it may come from the programmer, but the top-level comes from that, right? And then what will happen is that we're talking about a whole bunch of different planning techniques. So one planner will then sketch things out at one level of abstraction, but you need to call other planners to elaborate. So your architecture ends up being one of an architecture of planning systems at many different levels of abstraction where they're passing down goals from one planner to the next. And the coordination between those planners in terms of goals will be really key. Does that make sense? Good, excellent questions. Any other questions? Okay. So our challenge then is these systems, right, are becoming increasingly autonomous and they're performing more and more critical functions over long periods of time. We need to be able to architect those systems, right? To achieve robustness, they usually involve coordinating a large number of components. They may be components across the internet, or they may be an internal set of components to the system. So coordination is key. It involves a lot of planning, and right now that planning is mainly done by human operators, and that's becoming too challenging to address. So then what you want is both architectures, right, and programming languages to make it easier to do that planning automatically and achieve this robustness. Okay, so one thing to note is that there are autonomous systems out there. There have been autonomous systems out for 30 or 40 years, under the water, in space, right, controlling our grid and the likes. So autonomous systems isn't by any sense a new thing, right? The thing is that if you look at the current paradigm, right, for programming them, then they're usually programmed by writing scripts. They usually deal with failure by shutting down and asking for help, right? And so that leads to this issue of brittleness. And then in challenging environments, right, historically, you know, Mars now seems to be very good, but historically, you know, there was a lot of Mars missions that are lost, right? Now, if you look at Arctic under ice missions, then they tend to lose a lot of Arctic under ice missions, right? So those are situations where a paradigm, right, which is basically to fail safe, which is if you detect an anomaly, then ask a human operator to engage. Those are situations where that's not feasible. And in our daily life, autonomous cars, right, in a dangerous situation is another one where you can't just hand it off to the driver. Okay, so let's then talk about, that's kind of the context and the motivation for architectures which enable you to achieve robustness. Let me now talk about what those architectures have been like. Okay, so the first example that I mentioned earlier is Shaky the robot, right? I don't know how much Shaky is now in the lexicon today, but for decades it was kind of the premier example in terms of a robot, an integrated robotic system, and it's something that we still draw upon a lot of insights today, explicitly or implicitly. And Shaky the robot, right, was developed at Stanford Research Institute when it was tightly connected to Stanford, right? It had a planner which could plan paths and it used a
Plus, it had a robot path pattern based on a cell decomposition. So Shaky the robot introduced the A-star algorithm. So it was interesting as a system which had both a activity planner, with a domain independent activity planner, and a domain independent motion planner, right? Plus a whole suite of perceptual and natural language capabilities. So in this case, we saw kind of very early on the innovation of both activity and motion planning and the notion of domain independent planners at both levels. Okay, so then if you evolve from the 70s to the 80s, right? So people spent a lot of time on planning, right? Activity and motion planning algorithms, right? But these robots tended to be very slow. So there was a movement, and Rod Brooks probably was famous for it within the robotic community, which said, look, systems to be robust need to be reactive. There's lots of things in the world and environment, lots of animals that don't think. So the human approach to thinking is only one way to achieve robustness, right? Insects, mice, the like, are all systems, right, which can achieve robustness, right? In the case of the insect world, it doesn't seem like there's a lot of intelligence. So what he argued is that we really should be focusing on not deliberation, first and foremost, we should be focusing on reactivity, right? And in thinking about reactivity, often biological systems are designed in layers where they have these sense actives, right? And then evolution adds in layers, layers, layers. So the subsumption architecture was an architectural approach where you always thought about sense actives, that you layer them. Some higher level mechanisms are inhibiting the lower level mechanisms, and then they operate together. Okay. He also advocated not having an over reliance on decision making to the extreme that he would say, let's kind of ban decision making from the robotics. So he kind of pushed that extreme. But in doing so, what he did was he emphasized that first and foremost, we needed reactivity, and we don't necessarily need to have deliberation to achieve robustness. Okay. So that had a big impact on the community and lots of debates. And the Moose architecture is probably the one that's kind of embodies that kind of notion. But you'll see a number of those robotic architectures. Let me just step back one that I also meant to mention, that probably the current architecture, which is closest in some sense to the Shaky architecture, is the Ross plan architecture, right? And in this case, Ross plan is taking an updated strips planner, which is the set of PDL planners available in the ICAPS community today, and then that planner couples into Ross, which really kind of represents the lower level. Okay, so I do want you to understand that there's a whole variety of architectures that are available for you, depending on what your needs are. Okay, so there was then a lot of debate within the community. We had this deliberative approach, we had this reactive approach. How do we bring those together? So this was a very active set of debates about this for about 10 years. One of the most interesting architectures at that time that came up was to try to bring those two different worlds together into a three-tier architecture, right? So the upper tier, you were doing deliberation and kind of planning that was done since the strips days, right? There was a set of reactive skills which kind of represented the more behavior-based approach that Rod Brooks and others were advocating. And then in the middle, you have capability which would take the plan and it would execute the plan by coordinating with the set of behaviors, right? The set of subsumption-like behaviors, right? In between, okay? And that gave you those three tiers. Now, we kind of solved the top and the bottom of this architecture already before. So I'm going to zero in a bit more on the middle there, and that'll actually be important for you for today, because today's lab will really focus on reactive execution. So in the three-tiered architecture, right, it uses a language called RAPS, which you can think of it as an embedded reactive programming language, right? Right, so it's an embedded language reads sensors and writes to actuators, and it maintains a concurrent set of commands. So RAPS did that. But RAPS had the notion, right, of being what we consider to be a non-deterministic programming language and a goal-directed programming language. So here's an example of a RAPS. So a RAP is a procedure, right? So here's a procedure to attach at some site. These things with question marks are just variables, right? And at the very beginning, what it does is it tells you that at the end of executing that procedure, right, if it's successful, then you will be docked at that site. Okay. So the procedure includes a specification of success, right? It then has a whole bunch of different methods
So here it has two methods, right? And they apply in two different contexts. So this is giving you the applicability condition method. So it says that if the hull is ferrous, right, then you can use this method. Otherwise, if the hull is not ferrous, then use this method. So in execution, what the system would do is when you invoke the procedure, it first says, gee, do I already have success? If you have success, then it does nothing. Otherwise, it looks at the set of methods that identifies which ones are applicable. There can be multiple that are applicable, right? And then it would have some method by which it would arbitrate which of those methods to use, right? And then so it has this notion that it's a monitor, right? Normally, when you write a procedure, they're open loops, right? They never specify in the program what are the conditions that the world expects, right? You can write those into the program, but the program doesn't have any declarative specification of what it expects about the world. Right. The second notion is we write deterministic procedures. We always know what to do. In this case, you have multiple methods and then a decision-making algorithm deciding what to do. Okay. So those two ideas, right, we'll be leveraging quite a bit today. So we have this notion of goal-directed past decomposition. We have this notion of a non-deterministic programming language. Right, and we have the notion that the system is constantly closing the loop and determining whether or not its goals and sub-goals are being achieved. Okay, and that's similar in terms of languages to a number of different languages that have come along the way. Actually, before this, there were non-deterministic lists, right? So there was a schemer and a schemer, I think, were two early examples. In the logical situational calculus, there's GoLog. If you talk about decision theoretic programming, right, where there's a notion reinforcement learning to learn a policy of execution. And for this week, we'll be using a language firearm. Okay, now that's the notion in terms of programming language and the notion of goal-directed decision theoretic programming language. There was also work in terms of architecture, right, which kind of led to what we'll have today in ROS, right? So the task control architecture developed at CMU by Reed Simmons was developed for an early Mars rover, it looks a little called Amber. A little bit different than today's rover, though about equally massive, right? And so it provided capabilities for managing tasks and doing task decomposition in a goal-directed manner on a multi-processing system. It established communication node architecture, so inter-process communication, which were fairly seamless, resource management, and then later on top of that, the notion of execution monitoring and recovery. And a lot of that you'll see today in ROS. And there's a whole wide range of systems that kind of led to that, right? So player state, right, ultimately became ROS. I mentioned Moose before. PCA was folded into Carlin, which provided abilities for doing simultaneous localization and mapping. And then Clarity is an architecture which has both a decision layer and a mobility layer, like we have with Enterprise and with ROS, right, which was used within the NASA community, right, to coordinate their that Clarity is very much in the spirit of the architecture that we have, right? The difference is that that Clarity at its time was not open source. Okay, now the next thing that occurred in architecture that I want to highlight was the work in the mid to late 90s, right? In goal-directed system, model-based systems. So this I was involved in. It was called the Remote Agent Architecture. It was demonstrated in flight in 1999 on an autonomous space probe called Deep Space One. So Deep Space One was an asteroid comet flyby mission. It was a technology mission which was intended to demonstrate a number of different kinds of technologies, and the science was intended to be secondary. So in the case of mobility, it demonstrated enough onboard optical navigation, right? Which is that if you wanted to navigate for something, then what you do is you have the system think about where it is, it looks at the star map for interesting bodies nearby, and then plans to move the vehicle, right, the spacecraft to smooth the image those different locations, and then it does a course correction. At the task level, then remote agent was a system which was focused on being able to deal with failure, right? So prior to the development of remote agent, NASA had lost the Mars mission, which was doing an orbital insertion. And the problem at that point is that when it failed, it lost communication, so they really don't know what happened to the spacecraft, right? had been done over sort of decades as tools to assist the operators. The question then was, can we take those decision-making components and can we put them on board a spacecraft? So in the case of a remote agent, you have what's called a mission manager, which would have a set of mission goals, right? You have a planner, which would plan a sequence of activities, would deal with time, would deal with resources, right? It would then have a system which would be executing those plans. And then finally, a component which is monitoring and how doing diagnostics and visual repair. So those are kind of the three main decision-making components. But what was interesting is that all those different decision-making components, the part that's doing the planning, the execution, the diagnosis, and repair, all have a set of goals. They're passing around those goals to each other, right? They're constantly monitoring those goals to see whether or not there's a failure. And then in order to decide how to act, right, rather than pre-programming a set of responses, they each had an engineering model of their level of satisfaction of the spacecraft, roughly a set of schematics or a dictionary of commands, right, some models of components, and it was using from those models to do the three levels of decision making involved here. Okay, so it was commanded by using goals at all levels, right? Kind of what we saw, you know, I mentioned earlier in terms of PCA, or in terms of the three-tiered architecture. The reasons we have latency here, so apologies. Okay. It reasons extensively for models, so that's new, right? And a domain in that matter, and then it closes the loop on the goal, and it can be diagnosed and repaired. Okay. So that was a significant demonstration at that time, right, in terms of domain independent model based planning methods, right? It was only the 20 megahertz of a processor, right? And in fact, the diagnosis component had 2 megahertz of that, and then the planner about 40% of it, right? So about, you know, a little less than 10 megahertz. So you didn't have a lot of computational power. And for the planning problems, which involve time and resources, right, that's a very difficult planning problem. So a lot of the main dependent heuristics have to be programmed in by the engineers. And now, fast forward 20 years later, planning algorithms become dramatically better in terms of their ability to be able to plan a course of action, right, without having to pre-program through a system like that. And YARD will be kicking off, I guess it's on Wednesday, right, a series of tutorials on domain independent activity planning. Okay. Next, what I want to do is to just highlight a couple components, right, which kind of, that you saw in this or evolved off of that. Is the notion that once you generate a plan,
so
let me kind of give you two examples, right? But then you'll be seeing that a lot today, right, in the tutorials, right? So one example of a model, right, is that I have an engine that's not thrusting, right? So I think about why an engine is not thrusting. I think, well, one possibility is that a valve is not closed. So how does the decision system realize that, right? Well, it has a schematic and it has a model for valves, and what it's told is valves open, they close, and they close, right? Flow, things don't flow, they stick closed, and they stick closed, they still don't flow. So that would be an example of a model of a device, right? If I was taking an action, right, then I might want to say that if I want to pick up an object, right, then in order to pick up that object, right, my hand needs to be free, and the net effect of picking up that object is that my hand has the object and it's no longer on the ground. In that case, that's a model of a command in terms of what conditions we expect to form it, and then what are the models of the effect. If I want to do pathfinding, right, then what I would be doing is I want to be able to represent the free space, right? Maybe I'm certain. And then there's another actual robot and I want to model the dynamics. Okay, so those are probably the major kinds of models that we'll be seeing here. Okay, cool. Okay, so one of the next ideas, right, I think in terms of architecture is the notion of flexible execution, right? So when we generate a plan, right, a planner should decide exactly when to do these things, the start time, the end time, how much of the resources that are taken. If we're doing motion planning, we can decide an exact trajectory to follow. If we do that, right, then if any anomaly occurs, right, if it turns out that I'm running a little bit late, then my schedule may not work, right? If it turns out that I have a path, right, and somebody's moving, In the case of motion planning, right, you might have a notion that the motion planner actually is following tubes of trapeze to move through, and then the executive can decide they have a path along the way. Okay. So that's the notion of flexible execution, and Bob Morris will be talking about, yes?
Yes.
Later in the third report. Another notion is one of coding reactivity or making the decision components to be more reactive, right? So a lot of work has gone into thinking about how can you exploit properties of the domain which allow you to still have domain independent planners, right? But what are those cases in which you can generate plans very quickly? So the notion of one is rather than generating a plan and executing it, what you should be doing is generate a plan, execute the first action, right? Then check the state of the world, see if it's the desired state or if it's changed, and then generate a plan again, right? So after executing every action, you want to be able to generate a plan, but you want to be able to do that very quickly. Well, it turns out that if you look at different properties for different domains, for example, in the case of spacecraft, if you look at what's called the causal structure of how components interact, if those causal structures are acyclic, right, then it turns out that rather than this being an NP-hard planning problem, it turns out to actually be a polynomial planning problem, and in fact, you can generate a plan in time proportional to the length of the plan. So in those cases, you can generate these plans very quickly, and in fact, you can pile out the set of possible plans. So there's been a lot of work in terms of making planning systems to be domain independent, but more reactive by exploiting properties of the physical domain. If you look in the side of motion planning, right, so in the case of remote agent, that was one of the early examples where people were doing a lot of onboard decision making, right, although you didn't have a lot of time, right? At that level, it mainly focused on kind of scheduling, activity planning, right, and diagnosis, right, which were really leveraging off of capabilities for scheduling and for logical satisfiability. And SAT software became much, much faster, scheduling algorithm became much, much faster. You know, around 2000, right, then linear programming, mathematical programming started coming into its prime. So you could start solving trajectory optimization problems online, first in the process control industry where things are very slow, and then start shifting to autonomous air vehicles and the like. So first is then the whole kind of movement in terms of model predictive control or receiving horizon control, where you solve an optimization problem online, which is a path-dependent problem, right? You start executing it, you look at what your current state is, and then you keep moving plan. Right? So you'll see that a lot of the progress here. And you've seen an evolution from being able to do online optimization using linear programs and then mixed integer linear programming. And then nowadays there's a lot of use of convex optimization. So the Falcon 9 landing, right, which many of us have been stunned by, it was using a convex optimization to come up with this landing. So the ability of very fast but convergent decision-making algorithms have had a huge influence in terms of how we architect these systems. Okay, now once we have systems which can be used by models, right, and they have the ability to do very fast kind of domain-independent decision-making, then you need to kind of go back and say, how does that change your notion of programming these embedded systems, right? So we talked earlier about the notion of goal-directed programming, and in the case of RAPs, it had a set of conditions that it was checking along the way, but the programmer was still giving different methods to achieve goals, right? So in those cases, you as a human programmer was still doing the planning, right? The system was assigned a vision method, right? But it wasn't reasoning from a model. So the test ends up being is, what are the programming paradigms which allow you to establish goals, right? While letting the decision system decide the course of action. So one idea that we pursued is the notion of state-based programming, right? So the notion of state-based programming is that often when we talk about a goal, we think about a goal as a state of the world, an abstract state that we want to achieve. So when you think in terms of goals as opposed to doing it yourself, then you're really thinking about the state of the world that you want to be in as opposed to actions to achieve those states. But in a rich world, right, we don't usually just think about the end goal, right, which is having completed the summer school, right? We think about to Boston, we think about the fact that we want to then come to the status center, right? We want to eat lunch. So those are goals over time. So we can think of that as a procedure, right? But it's at the level of states as opposed to exactly what action. So the notion of state-based programming is you write a program, right? But what we do is we, and in embedded programs, you read sensors and you write a program, right? Here we say that all the states of the world are fair game. So you can read any state of the world and you can write to any state of the world, right? So the program, the state-based program look like any other reactive program. The thing is that the state of the world may not be directly observable and the state of the world may not be directly controllable. So the decision problem is whenever you ask about the state of the world, then the decision system needs to be able to infer from the sensor information what that state of the world is. Whenever you say achieve a state of the world, then the system needs to decide a course of action to achieve that state. So that's the notion of state-based programming. So if you then talk about kind of implementing the notion of state-based programming, right, and you think about how that changes the architecture, then what we said a little bit differently is that we have this architecture where we had time-consuming planning, and then an executive which executes that plan, right, which has some flexibility. We're adding more flexibility here, right? But at the level of state-based programming, what we said is, well, our plan has to become very quickly. So what we're going to do is that we're going to make the procedural language be the king, and we'll allow it to talk in terms of states. And then we're going to take the deliberative planning component, and then we're going to put it under the executive. So we flip the world, right, so that we are now thinking not as planning, or task planning is the big thing, and then there's this lowly executive, right, in some standard programming language. What we'll be thinking about is when we write these programs at the higher level of abstraction, right, and then all the decision-making is very fast and folded into the process of executing the languages. So we separate the barrier between plan and then act, and we have this view that we're constantly planning and acting, okay? And then our architecture needs to support us. Okay, so those are just a couple of different views and themes, right? Of course, there's been a lot of work, right, in terms of architecture. I'm just kind of telling you one story. It's not the story, right, but it's just one. But that emphasizes for you the notion of ultimately we're evaluating to the notion of goal-directed systems, right, that we have languages which are making explicit the goals, we have architectures which are communicating goals, right, that they're constantly monitoring the goals, and they're constantly adapting and replanning. So decision-making is a very fluid process.
Okay, so now,
when we architect these systems, what we do need to do is we do need to attend to the fact that these things fail,
right? So managing risk will be key. So in all these decision layers, you need to be able to think about the issue of risk along the way. And one way that we deal with risk, right, as humans, right, is that when we want to achieve robustness, right, we didn't think this, but evolution thought about this or whatever, that the way that we achieve robustness is through many layers of defense. So when you architect a system, you don't want to have one approach to robustness. What you want is many layers, right, to be giving you adaptivity and then have them work in concert. So in the case of the human, certainly we have, right, our immune system, which is maintaining black and white lists, right? But we also have physical barriers. We have skin, for example, right? We have inhospitable environments, such as our saliva, right? We have cell death, right? We have some tolerance to the system not functioning optimally. And it's really all those things working together to give you robustness, right? So in terms of architecture, you want to think in terms of a set of architectural themes, which are different paradigms which give you robustness. And all the components need to support each of those paradigms, right? So in our case, we want the notion that the system is always suspicious. That is, it doesn't assume that when you take an action that the action is correct. So it's constantly monitoring the effects of actions, ensuring that the effects that they have are what's intended, and more importantly, whether or not the effects, when they're different than expected, whether or not they matter. Okay? So we'll have the notion of monitoring goals and states, and the second tutorial today will talk about that. We have the notion of being reactive and adapting to disturbances, and today, right, we'll see the ability to kind of adapt by adjusting timing and by selecting contingencies. We want the system to be state aware, so it has the notion of what the goal states you're trying to achieve, it plans to achieve those states. Then we have precision, so it views this as a hybrid discrete continuous system, and it's always coordinating, estimating both the continuous and the discrete.
state. It's always planning the continuous motions as well as the discrete activities together, and that it manages risk taking effectively. That the system has some explicit notion of what is acceptable failure, what's not. It's always assessing its course of actions and trying to decide whether or not something's safe or not, if this doesn't apply. So if the system doesn't, the court says, I can execute this plan, and the system is certified, right, that it based on its probabilistic models, can guarantee a level of success, right, the court embarks upon a mission. Okay, and so you'll see some of these themes, right, kind of tied throughout out the summer school.
Okay, the particular architecture that you'll be using, right, will be something called, that I mentioned before, called Enterprise and ROS, right? ROS is publicly available, right? We also are making Enterprise available as well. It has this decision layer, right, as well as a mobility layer, right? And I won't say that much about it here. You will become more and more familiar with it during the afternoon labs. So if you then look at the structure from here on, right, then mainly what we'll be doing is to talking to you about the decision-making components, right, which populate this architecture, and then there's a couple of themes. So you'll see a wide set of tutorials which are dealing with planning, where they view planning as state space search, maybe a discrete or continuous state space, and they're trying to move forward from an initial state to try to achieve a path to some goal. A second theme in terms of planning, right, will be that we'll frame the planning problem as some form of mathematical program or some kind of constraint program or some hybrid between the two, and then it will solve that constraint program in order to come up with an activity or a task plan. And we'll see methods that use a very wide, rich set of representations, including logic, finite domain constraints, global constraints, linear constraints, convex constraints. And then finally, we have a lighter touch in terms of the perception, but Luca's tutorial, right, which will be the first one, will be kind of begin by looking at perception and mapping. I will then give a tutorial in terms of monitoring, right, and monitoring goals and diagnosing failure, right, before we slide more into the planning and execution. And then we'll kind of revisit the perception side on Thursday when we start talking about manipulation. Okay, so the last thing that I want to do, where's Marlise? That's okay. Okay, that's fine. Okay, so the last thing I want to do is to just touch a little bit lighter on the notion of programming. Okay, so there's three themes, right, that we've kind of seen before that I want to highlight. One is the notion of programs that make choice, right? The second is programs that monitor state, and then the third is the notion of programs, right, that achieve state. Actually, I'm going to give it in a little bit of a different order. Okay, so here's an example, right, that I gave you earlier, right, which was RAPS, and there's a number of different languages which are like it, right, that offer robustness and flexibility, right, through the notion of functional redundancy. So here's an example of a program in RMPL, and they'll be using this in the afternoon. So this is just an incurrent embedded program, right, and in this program, right, what it's doing is it's telling you that we want two robots, right, to go and image two different areas, right? And here's the program on the left-hand side to do this. So this program is simply telling what each rover should do. It goes to a set of waypoints, then it forms a set of images, takes a set of images. Now, in this program, we offer some level of flexibility here. And in particular, we told the rovers what course of action to do. So there's no flexibility in the set of actions to do. But what we have done is to give flexibility in the amount of time. So here we've specified, you know, we want the rover to move to the first waypoint in 5 to 10 minutes, the second 5 to 10 minutes. It has 2 to 5 minutes to do the imaging, and then so forth, right? So, but we want them to arrive at the same time. So if one rover slows down, then the other one can adjust its timing, right, to adapt. So that's the notion of a non-continuous programming where the flexibility is in terms of the continuous time, in this case, time, and bottom. In the last tutorial today, we talked about this quite a bit. And here's an example of a fragment within RMPL, right, where in this version of RMPL, we can have primitive actions, right? We can bound the time of execution of an action or a sub-procedure, and then we can piece together actions and sequence in parallel. So that defines the grammar programming. And then the problem is how do you execute that program, and executing it mainly involves a lot of scheduling.
flexibility, right? By giving the system other actions, right? And then the other thing to say here is when we decide when to do things, we could either decide when to do them beforehand, right? Or we can see how things are evolving and then we can adjust the timing. In those cases, we need scheduling algorithms that are very fast, right? They can wait the last minute to schedule something, but while guaranteeing success. So a lot of work has been done on how we come up with policies to schedule and adapt very quickly. We can carry that into motion planning as well. Okay, but suppose we want to have more adaptivity, right? So you plop a rock at one of the waypoints where you're doing the imaging, then you can't take an image. So we can add in some more flexibility, right? So in this case, what we can do is to say, well, we'll give two poses for each robot, right, where they can do the imaging, right? So rover one can image in either of these two different locations, right? The same thing for rover two, right? So here is another sequence of actions, right, where we have different viewing angles. And then if we want to be able to encapsulate that, then we can encapsulate in the plan, right? So here's a temporal plan, a set of activities, a set of timing constraints, but we've added in a non-deterministic choice into the plan, so there's different choices that we can make along the way, and then we can roll that back into our programming language as well. So in this case, the decision problem is come up with a set of actions which are feasible, for example, the object are not included, and are schedulable, and then you can add in the notion of utility, it becomes a decision theoretic program. Okay. So today you'll deal with decision theoretic programs, right, which are time programs, right? In the second tutorial today, I'll tell you about the decision-making algorithms that allow you to do that. But I'll be teaching them to you in the context of Dynamics. Then Bob will talk to you about dynamic scheduling, and then you'll go into the lab and can play around with these kinds of programs. Okay. And then in this case, we can augment our language. So in addition to having primitive actions, parallel and sequential composition, time-bound, we add in decision theory.
So what is the decision choice exactly here? Is it the partial plan that we are deciding?
Yeah, so if I back up, right, so we can think of this as a temporal plan, right?
Okay.
Where here's the timing we're allowed to specify for each activity. We construct a plan, and the way that we construct the plan is for each of the alternatives we make a choice.
Okay.
And then we come up with a schedule, which is the start and the end time. Does it make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So, what's important? Go ahead.
How do you evaluate the value of the utility before you evaluate the utility?
Well, so in this, all right, so in this case, what I want you to do is to just get a sense of the paradigm, right? In this particular case, right, the utility will kind of emerge in two different places. There may be kind of, well, first is when you perform some actions, there may be a utility and a cost, right? Okay, so you have a utility and cost associated with those actions. If those actions are something like go from A to B, then that action is actually implemented by a planner, and that planner would generate a plan and then would have to give you back the utility, right? In addition, right, there is some utility to the user in terms of achieving a set of goals, right? So we would associate a utility with each of those choices. And then automated language is bringing together those two notions of utility, value with respect to achieving the goals, right? Does it make sense? And here, what I've given here is fairly simplistic because I've just added a utility on action, which you don't see the action representation here, and I add a utility with the choice. Okay, but that's just a proxy. Other questions?
Excuse me, what does parallel matter? Is it just the start together or the end? If what happens is those branches doesn't match exactly as primary together.
So in this case, it just depends on the semantics of language. The way that this one was defined, right, in parallel is they start and end at the same time. Right? But there's different choices that you can do. Right? I mean, because if you want to talk about the time at which they both come together, there's different semantics for parallel, right? Then you either have a more flexible notion of parallel, right, which is the time at which they both complete, but then it's hard for you to say they both complete at the same time. Or what you do is you use the interpretation of parallel that I gave you, but then you say you go there and then wait. Okay, and the likes. Okay, so. When I do dynamic scheduling, which is what Bob is going to talk about, right? Then I can say that not only do I want to do scheduling on the fly, but I want to do resource allocation. Right? So in those cases, I may want to say there's actually a chain of paths as opposed to two parallel paths. But what I want to do is I want to decide based on the availability now what robot to do now. Right? So I want to do both resource assignment and scheduling, but I want to do it on the fly. So I want as much other questions? Okay, good. Okay, so that's the notion of decision theoretic programming, right? And today, right, we'll talk about you know, programs like this, where they're going to be making an optimal consistent set of choices, which are schedulable, and then we'll talk about dynamically scheduling them. And you'll be playing around with that in lab today. You'll use a planner called PERT for that purpose. So the next thing I want to do is talk about the concept of program on state. Ashkan, how are we doing on time?
6 minutes.
Okay, cool. Okay, so I wanted to talk about the notion of programs on state. Okay, so here I'm going to give you an example of a program on state. Okay, so in this case, right, we have the problem is to put out a fire, right? So I have a helicopter here. I have two fires to put out, right? I want to avoid the helicopters. I want to avoid the mountain. I can pick up water at these two lakes, I can need fuel. Okay? So I write a program for it. So if you buy any kind of autonomous vehicle, no matter how cheap or expensive it is, then usually it has a command dictionary, right? So here for a UAV, we have a set of commands that we can perform that are built in, which is we can take off, we can land, we can load water, we can drop water, right, of various types, and then we can move between A and B. Okay? So these are the actions that the UAV can take, right? And here's a program which specifies a sequence of actions. I've only given you a small fragment in this version because it's a real pain to look at. So this simply says, okay, the UAV takes off, it flies from the base to the lake, it loads water from the lake, it then flies from the lake to the fire, it drops water from high altitude, it then gets some more water, it drops off again, right? So that's how we program these systems today. The way that we program these in the state-based program is instead we say, okay, I decided I want to fire one out first because it's really raging, then I want to put fire out two, and then I want to be back at the base. Okay, landed. Right? So that's what this program is. It's specifying. Looks like a set of actions, but what it's doing is it's specifying a set of states about the world. In richer versions of language, I can add in time constraint. I can talk about probability of success or failure. Right. But the basic notion here is I write a program which is specifying states to achieve. And then in this case, what I notice is that when I specify the actions here, I also specify how they'll behave. So this says here that if I want to take off, right, if I want to land, then before I invoke that action, I should be flying, and
have a specification of the behavior of those primitives, the executive for the language can use that information to achieve these states. So here's an example of executing that program in RMPL. Right, so the first state that it was trying to achieve is the fire one to be out. So you see that it decided to put out the fire, or sorry, to get some water. It then goes to the fire, it drops the water, gets some more water, puts it out, does the same things to the second fire, and then goes and finally lands. Okay? Now, in order to execute this program, right, the program that I wrote was quite simple, right? And if I wanted to say I now have two UAVs, then it's very simple to say there's two UAVs, and then I would say some plane puts out the fire. Or in fact, I just said the fire, I didn't say what plane puts it out. Right? So I can get a very diverse set of behaviors, right? In order to execute this program, right, it was planning a set of activities and it was planning a set of motions, right? So it was doing activity planning and motion planning, right? The planner here, right, in some of these versions we would use FF, which York has developed, right? We'd use a whole range, and then on Wednesday you'll be working with a number of these kind of planners, right? And then we needed to do motion planning. Here was a very crude motion planner, so it was actually using a visibly graphed motion. Right, in the real world, we'll do kind of a risk bound or trajectory optimization. So you'll see a fairly rich set of tutorials on that. So what's important here is that if you can program in states and you have very fast, powerful planners, right, and you can really elevate the level of abstraction, you can get significant robustness. It is the case that if you enrich the problem, for example, you have time constraints and the likes, then the activity and the motion planning really starts to become a couple of problems. Okay, so that's why you can't just be two different research communities. Okay, so that's the notion of state-based programming. And as I said, in this case, the system just had a set of preconditions and effects. It didn't have models and times and the likes. Fairly rich language has been developed, right, for representing action models for planning. So the planning domain description language has been developed within the ICAPS community. And it's used for doing competitive benchmarking, right? But it also provides kind of a standard language that most planners can work to adopt some subset. And they have this notion of preconditions and effects. Those can extend into time, durations, and the like. So the tutorials you'll see will talk much more about these different variants of the language, and then on Wednesday you'll get experience with modeling 50 different planners at different levels of capability. Okay? So the final notion, right, is the one of programs that monitor, right? And actually what I'm going to do is I'm going to defer on talking about this until tutorial number two later today, right? But I'll give you kind of an example of what it means to be monitoring on state. And instead, given time, what I wanted to do was to give you a little bit of the context for the grand challenge. Okay, so we'll be rolling out the grand challenge later, but let me say a little bit about that. Okay, so as we mentioned, right, what Marlies mentioned is we've had a number of ocean cruises that we've been involved in, and those have been giving us a great opportunity to demonstrate, right? We had experience in NASA missions, but it's just much more difficult to go off and commission a NASA mission, right, to do these things, right? I guess it's like about somewhere between a quarter to $500,000 on the cheap, where these cruises only cost $50,000 a day, which is much, much cheaper, right? So we went off on the Falkor, right, for 3 weeks, right, and we were in the Lanai Channel here, right, and we were analyzing the coral reefs, right. It's a crew of about 20 and maybe about 18 scientists on board, and the ship is basically a hotel, right, which is taking the scientists on site and then supporting the operation of drive, brought them different autonomous vehicles. And we had about a half a dozen autonomous vehicles that we were operating and about a half a dozen science teams, right? So the question was, what is it like for operating an autonomous underwater mission where you don't have one vehicle? So traditionally you have one autonomous underwater vehicle, one remotely operated vehicle, and you have 40 people who are operating those resources. That's $50,000 a day to just operate two vehicles. The thing that we were pushing towards is that every scientist has their own vehicle and can operate about a half a dozen to a dozen of these vehicles at once. But they tend to be very, very different, and their modalities and their time scales, whether they're on the surface or below the surface, 2 or 3 years ago now, I guess we went to Scotsby, which is between Australia and the East North Sea, and we just said, what is it like to operate these vehicles? It was chaos, right, at one level, right? So we had one vehicle which was doing planning for itself and was trying to navigate around all the other ones that were hand-coded. Here we came back 3 years later and said, could we fold more planning into multiple missions? So I'll just show you a little bit of what we did. So here, I think Marlies showed this before. So here's the Falkor, right? Schmidt Ocean Institute provides us the time on that vehicle. It was founded by Eric Schmidt. Here's our vehicle called a glider. Marlies talked about a glider. You might think about an air glider. No, it's an undersea glider which has wings and no propeller. People later ask me, how the heck can a glider go off for a month at a time with no propeller? I might be glad to explain it. Here's a vehicle, right, which has high resolution camera, very maneuverable, but it can only operate for about 8 hours, where the glider can operate for about a month at a time. Okay? The vision we have is we want robots to be able to collaborate effectively to do science, right, which is their observing systems, right? So they want to characterize and classify parts of the reef. We wanted humans to collaborate effectively. So it turns out that the ship is the bottleneck, right? So the ship deploys the vehicles, it has boats, you put the autonomous vehicles on the boats using cranes, you then send them off, you then deploy them, you then pick them up, right? So humans need to collaborate effectively, and that's both the science team and the crew, right? They need to adapt the science opportunities on the fly. Every day we analyze the science data, and then you want to adapt, but you want the system to be much more adaptive to science, right? And then you adapt to risks on the fly. So one of the examples was our glider was out, another vehicle was supposed to be picked up, and then we noticed that a whale watching boat had gone off to our glider and was looking over. They seemed to be a little bit too interested. They kind of leaned over, they started picking up our glider, and so we decided to recast, right, that it was more of a higher priority to go get our glider, right, than the other vehicle, right? And there was just constant changes right in the operations and the risks that you don't expect. So in this case, we used a version of Enterprise that knows about risk, it knows about time, and in this case, it was doing planning to maximize information gain, so a form of adaptive science. We are interacting with the chief scientist and the bridge officer to coordinate the crew, right? We were planning the tasks, right, of the activities that the vehicles would be performing overall, and then we were doing a risk-bounded motion planning, right? So I'll just give you a little bit of sense. So the important notion here is there's really planning at all levels of these missions. So it isn't just deploying one planner. It's an issue of there's a wealth of planning problems, and we need those to work together, right, to effectively do these missions. And you really can't do this scale of complexity of missions unless you have decision-making and planning capabilities to help you out. It's just too complicated for the human operators. So here's an example of planning for information gain, right? And Oscar Pizarro will be talking about kind of information-based planning and model analysis, right? And his tutorials on Thursday. So we look at the data constantly, and then we identify what's either a set of interesting science sites to go to, or what's the trajectory which maximizes information gain in terms of improvement to the model, right? We then have to make sure that the vehicle goes safe, so there's a pair of planners, right? You may notice a certain naming convention that we use to go along with Enterprise to try to come up with a motion plan that's safe, and Ashton will be giving a tutorial on Friday on risk-bounded motion planning. We also have a planning problem that we have multiple vehicles that we're operating in coordination. So here's an example, right, where we're planning both the ship, its drop-offs, the autonomous vehicles moving around and coming back together. So in this case, the planning becomes much more complicated because it's a multi-vehicle planning problem, right? We need to be able to deal with the dynamics of the vehicle, right? So you have tutorials on trajectory optimization. We need to be able to deal with relative constraints. For example, vehicles have to stay within a certain proximity to communicate, right? Or because they're tethered together, right? And you need to be able to plan over very long horizons. So these motion planning problems are particularly challenging, both because we want the dynamics, and we could use nonlinear programming or context programming with the help of the dynamics, right? But we also have to be able to plan over very long horizons. So the normal approach of discretizing time doesn't really work there. Okay, and so Enrique Fernandez has a tutorial, right, on that, and I'll be helping out Enrique on that tutorial. And then finally, we did a lot of work in coordinating single autonomous underwater vehicles and a couple in concert, right? What we end up finding out is the most challenging part of these kinds of missions is not just doing the individual science missions, which involves one or a couple of vehicles, right? You have lots of different science missions that are occurring all at once. And as I said before, the challenge of the chief scientist and the bridge officer, which is to manage the overall campaign, is the most challenging part. So the barrier to being able to do these very ambitious missions will be actually helping out about the chief scientist and bridge team, both to manage the crew and the human operations, but then how do you couple that into the coupling of the vehicle dynamics as well. So we'll give you some examples of a system called a Aquora, which is helping to plan, but the human is making the decisions. The planning system has to effectively interact with the user to be able to figure out how to adapt, right, set of objectives. And I'll give you some examples of that later on. How are we doing? Okay, good. So that's the challenge that we have, right? As Robbie said, we did not include in your registration fee taking a DOI, I'm sorry. And we'll be giving you a much simpler version. Right, but if you stay tuned, right, then we'll be rolling out once you have some experience in your first day lab, the actual challenge that we'll be giving you guys, and then we'll be breaking your teams, and by Friday you'll be showing us what you can do. Okay? So then to just wrap up, right? So what I've done is I've tried to give you a history of architectures and then architectural themes that motivated this. I've also tried to give you some sense of programming, but you'll get much more of a sense of that in the labs. It's much more of an area that's still open to research, and then we'll be focusing on the tutorials. Today, what we're going to